But first, in a democracy such as ours, rules should never be made without reference to Parliament. That's why the Victorian government's proposed new pandemic laws are so seismic and have ramifications way beyond the state. They effectively license a single political figure to trump all other elected members of Parliament. It's against the very foundations of our Westminster system of government and has practical effect of making the executive supreme over the Parliament. That's why Daniel Andrews is so desperate to get these laws passed before the bulk of Victorian electorate wakes up to how really bad they are. Helping him achieve that is a motley trio of crossbenchers, the former sex party's Fiona Patten, Samantha Ratnam from the Greens, and the Animal Justice Party's Andy Medic, who overnight have done a deal with the devil to sell out Victorians for who knows what, if anything, in terms of a blood price, that could see these new pandemic powers ram through Parliament's upper house as early as late tonight. But it doesn't matter what the amendments are moved under this crossbench deal, you can't save a bad bill, and this seriously is a bad bill. Under these laws, if passed, indefinite lockdowns on nothing more than the Premier's say-so will be allowed, and indefinite detention without trial on the Health Minister's say-so too. And there'd be nothing in the ordinary course of events that Parliament could do about it. Everything that's already happened during this pandemic, the over-the-top policing, the arrests of pregnant mothers and elderly ladies, the curfews, the rings of steel, and the suspensions of Parliament could happen even more readily and with far less scrutiny if these proposed laws pass. To date, 60 QCs, led by former Justice Jack Rush, have signed a letter of protest against the government by decree. That's what they're calling these laws. And that's why the head of the Victorian Bar Council has described the laws as Stasi-like. And that's why the Institute of Victoria, the Law Institute of Victoria, and the Centre for Public Integrity, the Human Rights Law Centre, they've all expressed deep concerns. Today, even with the crossbench deal, the Victorian Ombudsman, Deborah Glass, said that changes announced overnight were, quote, not enough. So did the Victorian Bar. They too said the proposed amendments only addressed, quote, low priority issues, and not the lack of effective parliamentary control and the lack of provision for independent, truly independent review. Despite the proposed crossbench amendments, said the Ombudsman, Victorians could still be detained indefinitely without charge and without any right of appeal to a court. As well, because the new rules would be made by the Health Minister and not the Chief Health Officer, the Ombudsman's office would have no ability whatsoever to scrutinise them, because ministerial decisions, rather than ones by the public service, were outside its scope. If you heard Fiona Patten's spin today, you might have thought her explanation of the amendments meant more scrutiny, not less.
We have seen some significant shifts to greater oversight, greater scrutiny, and greater transparency.
Not so, as the 60 QCs pointed out in their protest letter, review by the Scrutiny of Acts and Regulations Committee, that committee of the Parliament provides, quote, very limited or non-existent accountability because there's no public debate and the government would always have the numbers on this committee. The only change of significance in the deal struck overnight with the upper house crossbenchers is that the Premier must be, quote, satisfied on reasonable grounds that it is necessary to declare a pandemic. But given the court's reluctance to intervene in executive government decisions, this provides very little practical chance for judicial review, which makes the changes not much better than window dressing or the proverbial lipstick on a pig. What was also telling today in Patten's Sky News interview was this.
I've been working on this bill since March this year.
Since March, she says. March, just after the third lockdown, working in secret with the Labor Party to strip away the rights of Victorians with these laws, yet it's only now in November that people and lawyers and the Human Rights Commission and all of us have seen anything of this draconian detail. Such is democracy in the once free state of Victoria. Now, in terms of timing, this deal with the crossbenchers all but guarantees these laws will pass and pass quickly. Indeed, for the Premier, the sooner they pass, the better, lest more people understand the sort of dictator-like powers he's giving himself. Forget a government confident in being able to defend these laws. They're not even prepared to defend them in the upper house and plan on shutting down debate if necessary to get them through. As Liberal upper house leader David Davis said here on the program last night, since the late 1990s, there's been no contentious bill gagged through the upper house. Now, gagging is a procedure whereby the government uses its numbers to curtail debate, to avoid scrutiny by parliamentary committee, and to get a bill passed by a certain time, come what may. It sometimes happens by consent on non-contentious bills, but Davis has never known it before for bills as contentious like as this. Now, even so, having been given some cosmetic concessions, another one being the reduction in maximum fines from $90,000 to $45,000, the crossbench have seemingly agreed to join the government in truncating debate and ramming this legislation through, even though it's completely unprecedented in an Australian jurisdiction for ministers to be given this almost untrammelled power to make laws by decree. Now, I've been encouraged, as I know you have, by the tens of thousands of Victorians who've got out to protest. But I fear the crossbenchers have sold out their fellow Victorians. And if, to our Parliament's shame, these laws do pass, Victorians have to remember that the ultimate sanction on a bad government is the ballot box. This time, next November, next year, there will be an election in Victoria. And we will see, won't we, just how good people's memories really are.